Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel. It's Russell with Ink and Paper Blog. Hope everyone is doing really well today. I am here today to do the spring reading tag. Mercedes over at Mercy's Musing was nice enough to tag me. I will link her spring reading tag video below so that you can check out what she said with these questions. The spring reading tag was created by Amy Jane Smith, my guess from, you know, I'm new to BookTube, so I've just started to watch a bunch of people's channels, and I've been starting to watch Amy's, and she does one of these, I guess, every season, and she's the one who created it. And I will link her spring reading tag video below as well so that you guys can check that out. I love the way she talks about books, Amy. She's just got this soft, gentle voice. It's fantastic. I think you guys will really like her if you don't listen to her already. So there are 8 questions. What does spring mean to me, though, before we get started? Now, I live in Northern California in San Jose, and most of the time, it's pretty brown here. We do get some rain, but the colors don't really come out. So spring is about a 2-month period where everything turns green. We're really lucky this year in that we've had a lot of rain, which we normally don't have. Lucky and unlucky, it's caused some issues. But green came early and it's still around. And when I walk around, I can definitely see all of the plants and stuff. So it's been pretty exciting. So on with the questions, because there are 8, it can take a minute. What books are you most excited to read over the next few months? So I picked 5 of them. 2 of them you've probably heard a bunch about, and then so I won't talk as much about them, and then the rest I'll kind of give you a synopsis. The first book I'm going to try to read this spring is Purple Hibiscus by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. This is the only one of her books that I haven't read. I've read Americana, Half the Yellow Sun, We Are Feminists, and her newest one, which I can't say that name, but I already talked about it in a video. So I went and I picked this one up. What do I know? Let's see. In the city of Enugu, Nigeria, 15-year-old Kambili and her older brother Jaja lead a privileged life. Their papa is a wealthy and respected businessman. They live in a beautiful house and they attend an exclusive missionary school. But as Kambili reveals in her tender-hearted account, their home life is anything but harmonious. Her father, a fanatically religious man, has impossible expectations of his children and wife. When Kambali's loving and outspoken auntie, Ifema, persuades her brother and the children should visit her in Nsukka, Kambali and Jaja take their first trip away from home. Once inside their auntie Ifoma's flat, they discover a new world. So I think that, I don't know, I've read a couple of books that have been set in Nigeria, but I don't know a ton about it. She is an amazing writer, so I'm really excited to read that this spring. The other book that I'm going to read this spring is My Cousin Rachel by Daphne du Maurier. Everyone is talking about the fact that this is going to be a movie with Rachel Weisz very, very soon. I love Rachel Weisz. I just saw her in a great movie that I'm kind of blanking the name on. I'm really excited about this. Lauren in the books is talking about it. I asked Simon what he thought about it. Everyone is really saying that this is really good. So I'm gonna try to read a bit more Daphne du Maurier this spring. The next book that I'm gonna read about is actually by one of my favorite American authors, Roxane Gay. This is her 3rd book and it is a collection of short stories. It's called Difficult Women. Now, her first book was a book of essays called Bad Feminist, which is really, really good. There's a fantastic essay in there about being a Scrabble, championship Scrabble player, which was really crazy. Her second book was Untamed State, which got really rave reviews. It's very dark, very graphic, but it's about a woman in Haiti who is kidnapped for money, and it's very heart-wrenching and also very my heart was like beating the whole entire time I was reading it. Now this is her latest book called Difficult Women. It's a collection of short stories basically about the lives of women and the human connections. I just saw her speak about this book and she read a bunch of different excerpts about it. The one that was the most exciting for me was a short story about a block within a gated community in Florida, and she kind of jumps between houses and the women that live in those houses and they talk about each other and kind of the drama that is the block. I thought that sounded really exciting. She's an amazing writer. She's very sparse, straight to the point, but also just packs a punch. So that's Difficult Women by Roxane Gay. The next book that I'm kind of hoping to get to is called The Gilded Years by Karen Tanabe? I'm not sure how to say that. What do I know about this book? This is a book about a mixed race girl, and I don't know, it's 1897. And she's mixed race, and she passes for white and winds up going to Vassar College. And she winds up getting involved with this very wealthy, very popular socialite girl who's her roommate at Vassar. And it's this juxtaposition for her between wanting to be part of that world but knowing that she's an outsider in that world because of the fact that she comes from a mixed-raced family, and she really, in theory, shouldn't even be there. And I guess there's some a love story with her roommate's brother, and then kind of all of that and the drama that goes along. And I just think it sounds really interesting. I think there's some power in this idea of hiding within a race and what that means. I'm really excited about it. I saw it on the shelf. I don't know a ton about it. So that's The Gilded Years about by Karen Tanabe. And lastly, I am going to be trying to read Lauren Grodstein's Our Short History. I actually don't know anything about this book. I've been talking to you guys about Booktopia. This is one of the books. But the story, the reason I picked it up was because of that, but the story itself sounds really exciting. It's about a woman who has a son who's 6 years old, and she is estranged from her ex-husband, and she now has decided that she needs to rebuild that relationship between her ex-husband and her son. Can you guys hear it started to rain? So I apologize if that becomes a problem. Because she is dying. And so she's going to try to rebuild that relationship, get through that while supporting her son, while she deals with her own mortality. So I think that sounds really good. That's Our Short History by Lauren Grodstein. I'm probably saying your name wrong, Lauren. I can't wait to meet you and you can tell me what it's really supposed to be like. The next question is, what books make you think of spring and for what reason? I'm going to just mention, too, when I think of spring, I think of the idea of things going and reinventing themselves or having died, plants having died and then reblooming. I think that's really an interesting idea. And I like literature that kind of talks about how things go through times or how people reboot their life. The first book is actually by David Rakoff. It's called Love, Dishonor, Marry, Die, Cherish, Perish. And it's a novel, and it's actually told in verse, so it's not very long, as you can see, but it's a verse poem that chronicles all these people through the 20th century. It starts in the start of it, and it's kind of like a poem that goes through introducing you to characters that are connected to each other, and as they go along, they bleed into each other's lives. He passed away right before or right after this was published. It's really cool. It's got some cool artwork in it. Let me see where they draw some of the characters for you. And it's not hard to read, but I remember when I finished it, starting it right over again because I was so moved by it. So that's Love, Dishonor, Marry, Die, Cherish, Perish by David Rakoff. And then the next book is actually just a feel-good story, and it's called The Storied Life of A.J. Fikery by Gabrielle Zevin. Now, this is the story of a man who owns a bookstore on a little island off of New York, and his wife has just passed away, and he's kind of trying to make that decision on what do you do after the love of your life disappears. And all of a sudden, a infant girl is left in his bookstore. And it's the story of him deciding what he's going to do with her. How he's going to, is he going to raise her? Is he going to give her to the state? And how she affects his life. There's another character in here that's like an agent for a book publisher that kind of gets involved in his life as well. They develop a relationship. And it's all about what do you do when the world kind of forces you to start over and you're not ready for it and something happens. It's lighthearted. It's heartwarming. It's well written, it's very straightforward, and I really remember just feeling that big sigh of a big hug and when it was over. So I really liked it. It's The Storied Life of A.J. Fikery by Gabrielle Zevin. The next question is, the days are getting longer. What's the longest book you've read? I want to say it's probably A Little Life by Hana Yanagihara. I think that's the biggest book I've ever read. I won't talk about it because I know it's been everywhere last year. I loved it. Simon loved it. Some people hated it. It was very polarizing, but I want to say it was a big book. It was almost 800 pages. I think that was the longest book that I have read. What book would you recommend to brighten someone's day? I actually have three choices here, three, I think, very different books. The first one is Miss Bunkle's book by D.E. Stevenson. Now, this is an older book. I think it was published originally in, 1936, first published. And it's just a fun book. It's about a woman, Miss Bunkle, who is a single woman who is running out of money to support her lifestyle. So what does she do? She writes a book about the town she lives in. She fictionalizes it. But she takes stories that she knows are going on around her from the gossip of that's been going around. And the book is published. And it's really about everyone in the town reading the book and realizing the book's about them. But she does it under a pseudonym, so they don't know who wrote it. So they spend the book trying to find her. And she spends the book trying to be hidden. But it's also doing remarkably well, so she doesn't want it to go away. This is a series. I think there's a second one in it, too. I remember just laughing and enjoying it and being really sort of taken away from what was going on while I read it. That's Miss Bunkle's book by D.E. Stevenson. The next book I'm going to tell you about is a collection of short stories called Birds of a Lesser Paradise by Megan Mayhem Bergman. I have met Megan. She is fantastic. And this is the book that introduced me to her. This is a group of short stories where all of the stories are linked in some way to nature or an animal or a family in search of something in that manner. So, and it says in the first thing, exploring the way our choices and relationships are shaped by the menace and beauty of the natural world. I loved this short story collection. I remember when it was over, I was so in awe that she was able to take a simple idea, like a parrot or something like that, and concoct this entire story around them. And it was so real and full of life. And I have read her second short story collection. I know that she is now working on her first novel. I really enjoy everything she's written so far. So that's Birds of a Lesser Paradise by Megan Mayhem Bergman. And then last but not least, this book is just good old-fashioned Southern fun. The Supremes at Earl's All You Can Eat by Edward Kelsey Moore. This book is the story of three women who grew up in the South together, and they are called the Supremes by the people that live there, and kind of their story, how they got together. It's kind of a saga of their lives. Also, they're older in parts of the story, so they're dealing with infidelity. They're dealing with cancer. They're dealing with friendships that have been there forever, and sometimes you just don't want to be friends with those people. And I think that that's really the powerful message. It is fun. It is funny. He is great. I've met him as well. And I really, really enjoyed this book. Odetta, Clarice, and Barbara Jean are fun women who you will enjoy getting to know in this spring season. They'll just brighten your day. That's The Supremes at Earl's All You Can Eat by Edward Kelsey Moore. Spring brings new life in nature. Think of a book that doesn't exist, but you wish it did. For example, by a favorite author or on a certain theme or issue. I had a hard time with this because that's not kind of my creative niche to come up with stories, but I was thinking about what would be interesting for me. And for me, I was really thinking about David Mitchell, who is one of my favorite writers. I've read, I think, almost everything that he's written. And Cloud Atlas is probably in my top 10 favorite books. And I thought, wouldn't it be interesting if David Mitchell were to do like a straight either fantasy novel or magic novel where he just took that realm over and created some sort of epic interconnected fantasy. He's so good at the interconnected story. I also thought it would be really interesting to see David Mitchell do something from the perspective of Africa, because I think he's done so many books where everything goes together, and that's such a country where all of those countries have some sort of interdispersed history, and I think he could make it work where you could learn so much about all of those countries and those people, and I don't know enough about them, and I want him to write it, and I want to just be in that world. Spring is also a time of growth. How has your reading changed over the years? Well, when I started reading, I was a straight fantasy reader when I was younger. And then I went into a place where in high school and college, all I did was read the classics because I was an English major. And that was really good for me because it kind of set the foundation of what kind of reader I was going to be and how I was going to look at books. So I read a lot of Charles Dickens. My degree is in modern American fiction, so I read a lot of Toni Morrison, Cormac McCarthy, that kind of stuff. And then my reading has really gotten to the point now, it took me a long time, where I read only for things that I really, really want to read. And if a book isn't doing something for me, I will actually stop it. And 2 or 3 years ago, that would never have happened. I would have fought through it, and I think it would have slowed down my reading. So I think really my biggest change is now just really owning what I'm reading, really wanting to read it, and then if it's not working for me, moving on. We're a couple months into the new year. How is your reading going? It's up and down, to be honest with you. I have felt like I've gotten a lot of really good reading done, but I've also feel like I've been a little bit slow because I've hit a couple of hiccups on books that I know I'm enjoying, but I'm just not reading fast enough. I was talking to someone the other day about reading quickly and how I try not to read fast just for the sake of getting a book done. And I think when I hit a book where I know I want to finish it, it really slows me down. So my reading has been inconsistent, but I've read some really, really good books this year, so it's been rewarding in that sense. 8, any plans you are looking forward to over the next few months? Well, as I've told you, I'm going to Booktopia. The beginning of May is my 40th birthday, so I'm getting ready for that. I'm going to meet a bunch of my friends up in Vermont. That will be super exciting. We're going to do a big vacation with a bunch of our friends later in the summer down to Palm Springs, California, where I will just be sitting by a pool and reading and relaxing, so I'm super looking forward to that. I think there's going to be a plan for what I want to do with my reading in my 40s, so that's something I'm really excited about, and that's kind of it. So I really appreciate Mercedes tagging me this. These questions really made me think. It took me a few days to even get my hands around it, so thank you very much. Who am I going to tag? Of course, I'm going to tag Simon. We all, if you've watched his last couple of videos, you know he's been doing most of his reading from the Bailey's Long List. I'd be interested to see his answers to these questions and what he plans to read next now that he doesn't have that there. I would really be interested to see if Jen Campbell would do this tag, mainly because I think if she did a spring tag, it would be full of fairy tales and dark fairy tales and happy fairy tales, and I think it would be really, really exciting to see what she would mention as spring books. And then finally, I'm going to tag Richard over at Richard Reads. Richard is a new booktuber like myself, and what I really like about him is that he is coming new to reading and booktube kind of at the same time, so he is not scared to try or read anything from Batman comic books to Moby Dick. So every time I watch him, the variety of what he is reading, it just is awe-inspiring to me. It is so vast. So Richard, I will link all three of their channels below. If you're not already subscribed to them, you should do it. I hope you guys liked my answers. I really liked this tag, and I will talk to you guys soon. Talk to you later. Bye.